Friends, we are starting now. Dr. Karnika Seth here. A very prominent lawyer, cyber lawyer, international expert, and earlier occasion also she addressed us. The today's topic is changing laws of data protection and privacy in India. I request Rahul will read one or two lines of our CV.
Just wait. Sure.
Dr. Karnika Seth is a cyber law expert and is an advocate, Supreme Court of India, practicing here. She has pursued an LLB from Faculty of Law, University of Delhi. She has pursued her LLM from King's College, University of London, and then her PhD from Noida International University. She is a visiting faculty at National Judicial Academy, National Police Academy, CBI, and National Investigating Agency.
We'll go by one introduction. Myself, G.Seshagiri.
Rahul Agarwal.
Please.
Vijay Padilwani.
Rahul Sharma.
Shikhar Pradesh.
Sohit Kumar Shah.
Rasun Kumar Mishra.
Shyam Sundar Gupta.
Amit Pratap Singh.
Brijesh Kumar Sanu.
Dr. Sophia.
Yeah, please.
Ubushi.
Yeah, 1 second, please come. Take this one. She will help you. Yeah, she will keep. Yeah. You just put this.
Over here? Would that be?
No, you remove that. Correct. Right. Now it's perfect. Please, Bob.
It's audible.
It will directly go to camera. Very perfect.
Okay. So, like I said, last time we had discussed cyber crimes. As been introduced, I am a cyber law expert. So, I've been dealing for the past 20 years this field of law, which is very new. Yet, we have been witnessing a lot of new crimes in this area, especially. IT Act is a main legislation, year 2000, which we follow. And the rate at which cyber crimes has increased is almost 10% every year. This is the usual statistics we've seen. But over the years, what used to be just hacking initially has transformed into a number of hybrid crimes. So last time I had discussed a few, this time also we will be touching on all these while we are doing case studies. But to give you a very brief idea, the kind of crimes which are percolating in this area, right from identity theft to blackmail, extortion, ransomware attacks, bullying, trolling which is on social media, harassing somebody on social media, making fake profiles, ATM frauds, credit card frauds, and a lot of you would see harassment, even obscenity, pornography, all these are different dimensions of this crime. So last time we were discussing crimes, and this time the focus is mainly on data protection and privacy. Some of these things will overlap, which is bound to happen, but that's good because then it will be also reiteration of some part of what I had explained last time. So when we talk about IT Act, first thing very clearly we need to understand is that although it was enacted in 2000, there has been some amendments over the period of time, and 2008-09 we had experienced major amendments in some of the provisions got incorporated, like 66F, which is cyber terrorism, and punishments are very stringent. They go up to life imprisonment there. And the definitions of hacking were changed. Somebody who takes a stolen resource and misuses that resource to make any kind of gains came about under 66B. Then identity theft, cheating by personation got added in 66C and D. And then E was violation of privacy. So these were new areas which we had not seen earlier. And the prescriptive jurisdiction of IT Act is very wide. it goes up to even an offense committed by a foreigner sitting abroad, but if he hacks into a system or a computer located in India or affecting any citizen in India or a company in India. So it is as wide as that. But the question you will appreciate is, how do we enforce this law? If supposedly a criminal sitting in X jurisdiction has hacked our computers in India, how do we enforce? Knowing that we don't have a cybercrime convention, the usual emulity processes to get any electronic evidence or cooperation from a foreign authority is very, very difficult. So that is a challenge. So when I say there is prescriptive jurisdiction, definitely that's there, but the enforcement is a challenge. That's one. Then there are a lot of different aspects of IT Act. One is, how do you electronically sign a document? Is it equal to a hard paper document which is signed, which is the case? So legal recognition has been given to electronic records. And then contracts, e-contracts, can also be formed online. So it's possible to just have an exchange of an email of offer, acceptance, and a consideration paid right there, or deferred consideration, and that's a contract. It's a valid contract. So that's one facet of it. The acceptance and receipt of documents is one aspect. Then comes the penalties and the offenses. And if somebody unauthorizedly accesses somebody's data or damages it, it comes under contravention. Especially if there is no, I would say, intention, but yet he causes a loss. I'll give you an example. Supposingly an employee goes, he's been asked to come to an office and work on a Sunday. He comes with a pen drive and he works on the system and goes back. There's no issue with that. In the second scenario, he comes but he's getting bored while he's working. He puts his music pen drive, starts working on it. In the process, he doesn't realize he has infected the system, which damages the data. That's a contravention, because he still has a liability. He has been careless. On the third scenario, if he intentionally puts a virus in the system because he's been asked to come on a Sunday, and he has, damaged the system or data in it, that's an offense. So it's very simple like that. Now, so there's a chapter, whole chapter on contraventions, chapter 9, and then chapter 11 is on offenses. And then we have digital signatures and encryption mechanisms to secure data. Now that takes me to today's topic. That's a background. But today's topic is data protection and privacy. So just refer to the definition, and if you refer to the definition in section 2.0 of the IT Act, it's very interesting. 2.10 says, I just want to read this only this definition, the rest we'll talk about it. Data means a representation of information, knowledge, facts. So when we say representation of information, like we have in IP cases also, it is not that idea is protected, it is the representation of that, the manifestation of that, how you represent that data. And then concepts, instructions which are being prepared or have been prepared or in a formalized manner intended to be processed, is being processed. So even a raw, semi-raw data will be covered there, and in a computer system or computer network, and maybe in any form, a data or Excel sheet, for example, if you've printed it and kept it in your file, is also data. So it's not that only the one which is in electronic format inside, stored inside the system or under process, is only data. So once the computer printout is with us, very much a data. And optical storage, media, constructs, or stored internally in the memory of the computer. So data as a definition is fairly wide under our IT Act. Semi-processed, raw data, even processed data, printouts or electronic, or stored in any removable media, will be data. Now, if we see the current protection under IT Act to that data, we have Section 43 of the IT Act, which talks about unauthorizedly accessing anybody's system or a computer or a resource, downloading, extracting unauthorizedly from any such system, damaging, destroying, altering from such system, denying somebody the access to this information, or causing a time theft, because there used to be internet is built. So that bandwidth which you get with the internet is also built, somebody can steal that as well. So that becomes a time theft. So, and if somebody steals a software which is like a source code and an object code involved in it. Very simply put, what is a source code? Source code, if you see, children play with clay and mold, right? So when you put the clay in the mold, and or when you put a 1 rupee coin and put a pencil on it, you will get an impression. So the impression is in fact the main object code, what you see on the screen, I mean to say that. And what you have inside that is the source code, which makes it function. So which is intangible, you can't see that. That's the source code, but the two are intrinsically linked. So one source code, if altered, will lead to a different object code, and some an object code with one particular, I would say, impression or a representation will have to have a particular source code behind it. So that's even if that is stolen, it becomes a source code theft. So now, what is the contravention punishable? A compensation can be payable by the adjudicating authority under Section 646 of the IT Act. And this contravention can be determined based on the quantum of loss suffered, how much damage is suffered, recurrent, how much is this, contravention recurrent. So based on that, they give a compensation. Now, having said that, if this is with an intention to commit a crime or dishonestly, it becomes an offence. And then is clubbed with hacking, which is 66 of the IT Act. 85 section of the IT Act is deemed liability of director. So supposedly an employee has hacked into the servers of another company on with a conspiracy with the company and the directors, the main management. It is not only he who is committing the crime, but also the people who are the main directors, who are in charge of control of that organization and are in the know of things, will also be liable. That's a deemed liability of directors. There is an exception. In case the director can prove that he had neither the knowledge nor the intention to commit the crime. So that has to be discharged by this director. Now, if we talk about privacy, fundamental right, we all know this case, Puttaswamy case now. It's been held as a fundamental right. It used to emanate from, this right as we understand today has emanated from an essay written by Brandeis and Warren, at that time, it's been many years when this, article was, essay was written. Not only rights vis-a-vis a private person or also the government. So there are two aspects of this whole privacy game. With the new, light which has been thrown on this right, we have new dimensions emerging, the changing landscape of data protection and privacy today. Because the privacy is not only going to be vis-a-vis the government, but also vis-a-vis other citizens, entities who are controlling our data. You have social media taking apps, taking so much data of ours without any right way of taking consent. That is why the PDP came into being, the Personal Data Protection Bill. Justice Shri Krishna Committee has laid down very clear principles on the basis of which any entity can collect our data. Now those are basically going to protect us. For example, I would say right to give a proper consent, that is there. Even WhatsApp for instance, now nobody can add somebody in a WhatsApp group unless they take a permission. So the explicit consent has to be taken. And it's not implied. So if you're tick marked a box without reading the entire, giving an entire consent explicitly, it will not be considered as proper consent under the PDP regime. But currently, even if you say I agree and okay without reading the terms, it is deemed consent. That's not going to be tenable later on, or not going to be legally valid later on after the PDP bill comes into play. Then the right to process data. Now, how the processing will happen, who is going to be the fiduciary? Data controller term has been changed with data fiduciary now. Because like we have banker and customer relationship, that fiduciary element has been added. Then data principal is now the term instead of data subject. And so you can control, you have a right to forget, to be forgotten. You can ask for changing a data if it's not correct. So there are various rights which are there, right to allow a particular processing of data. But what is sensitive data? Comes the next question. Data, what is sensitive data? The sensitive data is defined in the current regime as passwords, financial information, any kind of, you can say, financial data, biometrical data. But now with the PDP, if that gets enacted, religious, political beliefs are even placed under sensitive data. This, the sexual orientation of a person is going to be placed under sensitive data. So the expansion is there in terms of, I would say, aligned with the GDPR in Europe. We are aware of this data protection directive, the General Data Protection Directive. On 25th May 2018, it has come into effect in Europe also. So that was also a very strict regime like we are proposing in India. And with that, it's going to be, penalties are very high if somebody falters. What is the current security protocol? ISO 27001. If they don't follow ISO 27001, immediately you can report, there can be a breach, the affected party can report, and strong punishments are given. Mm-hmm. As much as in Europe, it is almost 20 million euro, or 4% of the profit turnover. And in India, it is going to be like 2% of turnover or 5 crore, whichever is higher. So you can imagine the extent of stringent terms which are there in this, going to be in this law. So that takes me to the code of conduct. So when we have BPOs functioning in India, they have a tie-up with, say, a foreign vendor. Now, if that is happening, data of our country, our citizens is going abroad, has to be modulated, monitored through a code of conduct. In GDPR also, they have model standard clauses. In India also, likewise, we will have model standard clauses. And if somebody doesn't follow that, there are heavy punishments. In terms of jurisdiction, the PDP bill talks about being applicable not only to the Indian companies who are processing Indian data of Indian citizens, but also the foreign companies who are coming to India to do, give their services. They are also accountable immediately. And it's also going to make the government agencies accountable. So it's not only that the private players are the only persons, but the government agencies are equally accountable. That takes me to the large advent. We all are aware that private banks and companies are not allowed to take away our data of Aadhaar unless we voluntarily consent to give away or for claiming subsidies of the government. Then there have been many other cases. I think there was one more case which I was reading and mentioned by you also. The AP government and the Telangana government. They have, there's been a dispute with a Hyderabad-based IT company who has stolen voter database data. That is still being adjudicated. The FIR in fact is also been lodged, and it seems to be a political data theft. So that these kind of issues are emerging with this landscape of changing landscape of laws. And then we have several employee data theft cases. Some of them I've only represented before various forums, TDSAT, adjudicating authority, or in the appellate court, that we have this, they go to high court directly also in the form of suits, in the copyright. So the jurisdiction I need to clarify is, for IT Act offences, we have no separate criminal courts. It's the same as our general courts. But for contraventions, we have an adjudicating authority, as I mentioned. Decisions from there will go to the appellate authority, which is now the TDSAT. Instead of the Cyber Appellate Tribunal, that power has been given to the TDSAT. And from TDSAT, go to High Court and then Supreme Court. So this is how it goes. Data theft cases are emerging because a lot of employees don't realize when they sign these stringent terms and conditions, they are also liable under IT Act, apart from copyright regime, your trademark violations or copyright, trade secrets, we all understand tort law also. That is also there. But this IT Act specially has created forums where the compensations are being claimed by companies whose employees have gone and after having stolen data. So those are new areas also emerging. And then we also have, other cases, but primarily when it comes to data, only high-stake litigations are happening because the if it is a loss which is not very substantial, generally litigants are settling out of court or they're not really going in with arbitrations. In this, more or less, when there is data which is very high-stake and a lot of people have spent a lot of R&D in R&D and otherwise, they're trying to recover the monies. That's how it is. So with that, landscape, the connected issues are the, when I said code of conduct is to be followed in enforcement, the new bodies which will be created, the Data Protection Authority. The Data Protection Authority is a key authority, and under that office also adjudicating authority is there who will look into compensation claims. But the Data Protection Authority will also be monitoring the entire enforcement model, bringing awareness among people and putting the standards which should be complied with the data protection regime. Then when we talk about localization of data, RBI has given a very clear mandate. WhatsApp, payment gateways, they are trying to launch new facilities. Similarly, other companies who are launching any kind of payment systems, they are not allowed to take data outside India. They are saying you put it here in India, have the servers very much in India. So data localization in itself has become a huge topic of debate. Does India have enough security regime in place, or does India have a law enough, strong enough to have localized data stored entirely in India? Should a mirror copy be stored here and should another copy be sent outside? These are some key emerging issues which we are all facing. Then we understand the legal regime needs to be strengthened. So sensitive data in the PDP, they are saying if you take away sensitive data, 5 years of term of punishment, imprisonment, instead of 3 years, which is for personal data but not so sensitive. But having said that, both the IT Act and the PDP regime, if it is not giving punishment more than 3 years, is a bailable offence. Now with bailable offence, we all understand it's not taken so seriously by the police either. So we need to, I think, make very stringent provisions to deter criminals or companies from taking away data like that. Then that will increase prospects of employment. No doubt, localized data will increase job prospects, will increase the confidence of the IT industry, definitely. But we have risks too. So we have to avoid those risks. We have to make our both technical and security and legal regime very strong enough to actually take on this role. Then who has the control over data? Obviously the citizen, he is giving away his right, gives his consent, only then they are allowed to take the data. Strict obligations have to be followed, that's okay. And if there is a falteration, there's somebody who falters from that, writs can be moved immediately. Right to privacy is infringed. Or the statutory liabilities, can be enforced, the provisions under the current IT Act and as amended. If the PDP comes into play, then 43 will be amended. In fact, omitted. That's how the PDP envisages. So with the GDPR regime, it basically says that the processors, they are equally liable as the ones who are storing. Same as with Indian regime. And two new categories of data they have added in the GDPR. One is the biometric and one is the genetic. And racial origin also. So it's also expanding. The dimensions in which we understand data are changing day by day. So we need to be basically geared up for this sort of exercise, and if there is a cooperation required from the data controller in terms of breach, they have to immediately act within 72 hours. and a child below 16 years, one has to take a consent that of the guardian. And below 13, he is considered as, you know, those apps or those games which are not so like really harmless. They are basically, if they are harmless, those are allowed to be, you know, operated, or accounts can be set up by minors, or a social media platform can be operated, or account can be created. But some things which require a person of you know, below, above 18 to consent, like a guardian, for that kind of apps, there has to be a proper consent. If a child is above 16, or even if that is the case, till he attains 18 years. In India, it is 18 years. I think there was one case in Delhi High Court where this was being debated, what is the correct age for a child to open a social media account. And that parameter was to be set. I didn't find that finally decided yet, probably still pending. But among parents, this is a huge issue. And I have seen that some schools are even giving iPads to the kids to study from, and have those modules in the form of small PDFs, the books, entire books on that, and using smart TV and these gadgets to teach, which is a good thing, but provided filtering is put, there has to be good mechanisms to monitor what they're doing, what they're seeing. Just yesterday, I was operating my phone and I realized that there was an SMS, and the SMS said that your 500 something rupees have been, you know, debited from your credit card, and for some Google AdWords. Okay, so I just thought, I have not applied, I have not bought anything, no service. Why is this there? But I knew this could be a phishing racket. And out of what is phishing? It's basically a fraud to gain your financial data so that they can misuse that information to steal monies from your account. So when I clicked on that, it led me to a Citibank page. Had I put my user ID password there, my account would have been hacked. But I'm a cyber lawyer, I knew this. How many people are aware of this? These are the problems. Then I've seen in ATMs, they have put hidden webcams. They'll just take that part out and won't realize the entire passwords have been taken, and the cloning has also occurred at times. Skimming machines are there on petrol stations and restaurants. And these are real life cases. And one of the cases I was arguing, in that case, bank has you know, debited certain monies for online gaming activity of a merchant navy officer who was not even using his that debit card abroad, but it has been shown as he has made so 98 transactions in the 2 months period, which we are still fighting that, you know, this should be reversed because the bank is negligent. They should have sent an OTP and an alert. He has subscribed to the alert system. There is a SMS to be sent, an email to be sent, or some OTP should also be sent. So all of us should have a two-step authentication on every account, bank account or a Gmail account. And with that, at least you are secure that, you know, nobody will misuse it, because the phone is with you. You will only access the OTP. Even if that password gets compromised, if you're clicking on a suspicious link which you don't think is suspicious. So the two-step verification actually helps in curbing these problems. That's why when we are talking about our data, our financial data is very, very crucial for us. Not only financial, personal data. So many parents put, or even otherwise people put, on Facebook or otherwise, that they're going out of station. And then tomorrow you realize there's a burglary happened at the house, because they are saying checked in, and they think this is very trendy to do that. But then they don't realize these crimes are happening. A lot of these crimes are happening, and surprisingly, in many of the crime cases, whether it's murder or it is any kind of crime cases, the IT, like the gadgets at the person's disposal, the victim's disposal, are being first scanned, because they will get traces. Just yesterday, day before, I was reading in the papers also, so a lady was, murdered. yes, her phone was trapped, and that there was a person from I think Rajasthan side or Jaipur side who was found to have talked with the lady just before this whole thing happened, and he had befriended her on social media. Am I correct?
Correct.
Yeah. So this is what is happening. The use of IT and the main, I would say, why the criminals are thronging this cyberspace is because they feel they are anonymous. They can actually hide after doing a crime. But that's not the case, because there's always a trail made. There is always a footprint. And any time you do a crime, there is a footprint to it. You can actually trace back. And with these intermediaries like phone companies now checking, making the KYC stronger, it helps in detection of crime. Immediately you can find out who is this perpetrator, for where is the IP address, because every machine has, or a phone has, internet access, and then it has an IP address, like a house address. So the moment there is a crime, this IP will show. Criminals are like one step ahead of us, so they will also have a spoofing tool. There are softwares to hide the IP also. But then again, sometimes those can be cracked. I want to discuss one or two very interesting cases with you. One was, which I just finished doing, was the company based out of, you know, India. This company is a back office to a foreign client. Our client was a foreign client, and he had given his website for being made to another vendor in the US itself. This US person had this Indian back office who helped in the making of the website. After this website was developed and it was handed over electronically by the Indian back office to this foreign company, and 10 days later or 15 days later, they realized that their servers were hacked. When their servers got hacked, they checked up through that platform which where the handover of these IP assets was done. It showed a footprint from where this is hacked, and it was the Indian back office. So they were like, you know, they want to file an FIR, they want to do something. So we filed a suit immediately for permanent injunction, like we have in the copyright cases also, IP theft cases. LC was appointed, we took an ex-party, LC was appointed, we went and raided the premises, office premises, took away the servers, we seized all the computers, sent it for forensics. So this is very, very important, because tangible data or intangible data can be destroyed very easily. So when this company was based out of Gurgaon, so there very interesting issues happened during the course of arguments. What is jurisdiction after all? Will this complaint or this case lie here or not? And this company is based out of, you know, US, the client is there, but the hacking has happened there. Why have a case here? So these are very interesting issues. But we could prove that some part of the contract was also fulfilled here and certain formalities were done here. So we claimed jurisdiction. Cause of action is a reason here. Right? So very interesting issues. Then there was a case of a lady who was based out of US. She and her family, they were staying there. And she contacted us saying that she's been defamed on social media and other websites, 15-16 websites. And these 15-16 websites were even holding her passport details, her letters she had written to an ex-friend. This ex-friend was based out of another country where she had a threat to her life. She says, I can't go there. She couldn't come to India because she was originally an Indian national, settled abroad, NRI you can say. But this embassy declined request. She says, it's a personal issue, we will not interfere. So what should she do in that situation? How should she block these websites? First of all, who is the creator also? She suspected him, but they had no proof. So when we looked at the internet and we saw these websites, we collected every information available. We found out that this person is in X country, and we recognized who is the holder of the website, ownership of the website. And there are websites to find that out. You can note down who is .net. Is a very good way of finding who is the owner of a website. And there is a who is .net.
who is talking.
Yeah, and you can see who is look up also. Look up. And then there is a very interesting time machine, back machine. Supposingly a website has a particular page today. And after coming to know that somebody is suspicious, deletes that page. If you want to go back to that page and take that evidence, you have to use a time machine. There is a crawler, web crawler, which takes photos of every important website and stores it like a backup, which you can actually access. So in number of cases, we use that to find out what was the content which was originally there and now it's showing the changed content. So on that particular day when this crime happened, what was the terms of use and what was being displayed? Third is the what is my IP or IP lookup. That is also interesting because you can actually, in an email, there is a header from whom it is coming, what time. If you see the full technical header, there's an option in Gmail also, full technical header, it gives you from, and just next to from, it gives you an IP address. If you type that address in the who is or this what is my IP, it will show to whom this service, which service provider is giving the services. So for example, if it is Airtel, then the Airtel will have the exact location from where this was done. That's how we root in our criminal cases also. That's how we find out the location of the offense. And in a very interesting case, there were two brothers who had run a travel agency. And these, they had some animosity, some, I would say personal issues. And then there was a racket or a scam where one brother was ticketing false tickets in the company of the other and using relatives' names. So obviously he was suspicious of him doing it, but he had no proof. Right? Nobody would show up at the airport at that particular time and the tickets would go waste. So we took up that data and we saw that all these tickets were being booked from those IP addresses which were in Russia or somewhere else. So he was using a proxy server. A proxy server is a server which will give you fake identities. The criminals use that. And so he was using that and giving Russian addresses and other addresses were coming. So one of the addresses happened to be Delhi. So what would have happened when he was using these proxy software or servers? His electricity connection must have gone. And when it relogged, he didn't realize it has happened. So he was caught. So that evidence was good enough for us to, catch hold of it. Now in the other case, I was on that lady's case. What happened finally, we wrote legal notices after having looked at the owner, who is the owner. We wrote legal notices to the website owner also, as well as the hosting companies. Every website has a registrar who register. Like we have in trademarks, we have a registrar. For every website also, Net4, other companies are there. So looking at who is the registrar, which you will get in the whois.net, you can write notice to them. And then they would respond after checking the page, concerned page, they'll block it. That can be done. So, these cases, we didn't even have to go to the courts for that. It just happened. But in certain cases, this may not be enough. So we have to come to court, especially if it is a US-based server or service. And it is showing defamatory materials about an Indian celebrity, for example. I happen to do another case of this kind for a spiritual leader. And those pages in that US-based website were blocked by the orders of the court. And the registrar of that website also cooperated and submitted to Indian jurisdiction. So these cases involve transborder, especially transborder crime, multiple agencies. Apart from the perpetrator of the crime, maybe you will need to have your registrar of the website or the owner of the website, then hosting company. They'll all have to be made necessary parties because they will be the ones who will be giving us the evidence also. And not it will not suffice merely to have them as witness. So that's another thing. So like I was explaining, data thefts are many and even employee data theft, some of them which I have seen, employees running a parallel company while they are still working for their own company, siphoning away data through pen drives, through use of, I would say, their own personal email ID. So it's very important for the companies to have stringent terms and conditions, which sometimes they don't realize, they don't make it airtight. So in many cases, we have been able to prove with electronic evidence and forensic reports that this email was copied, the entire folder of email called PST folder was copied and taken away in a removable storage media. These were the nature of mails, this time, and that report is very handy for us. So it becomes crucial to have that 65B certificate. I think last time you had a session on electronic evidence, so we have this Anwar versus Bashir judgment, and then we have many judgments following that trend, and then Shafi Muhammad. This latest judgment gives us some leeway into still using 63 and other means of proving secondary evidence wherever either the original device is not available or where you don't have the custody of the data and you cannot give 65B, yet you, if it's a third party document you need to prove, you can still prove that. So the electronic evidence is now becoming clearer as a field, yet a lot of issues remain. But we have fortunately been able to use electronic evidence to the benefit of our client cases because, and that's a clinching issue. Authenticity, admissibility is one aspect. Then is the authenticity of the, I would say, the content in it. That becomes the second parameter. So we can always challenge a forensic report with a counter, report. And that's a little difficult nowadays because the labs, forensic labs, are still too less, I would say, compared to the rising crime. And it's still taking about 6 months, a year. And there are some cases we have in, say, out of Delhi, in a place near Maharashtra, and there forensic labs are taking long to even give a basic report. So this is a challenge in data theft issue cases. But I just want to understand if you have encountered a situation or a case where this is a key issue, I would be happy to discuss those issues.
Anyone have any experience, bad experience by this data?
Any data theft, any privacy issue?
Suppose in a suit for recovery,
yes.
Accounts, books are maintained in a computer.
Yes.
65B certificate has been given.
Yes.
It's a false certificate. Computer has interacted with so many virus, it was got repaired and all this thing. Because the certificate will come from the employee's office only. So he will give as per the master's line. How you will prove that these are the manufacturer or these are not the correct entry in the computer? Because in earlier, in traditional mode, books of accounts is a regular way of keeping. You can tally it with, you can match it, which each entry, each payment. But here, if suppose he files it and gives in a CD form, and there is only 65B customary certificate, how you will demolish, knowing fully well the client is saying no, this entry is incorrect? How do you demolish?
The hard disk of that system will be needed.
That's forensic.
To forensically check how much, at what points of time this disk has been formatted. There is a place called slack space in the forensic reports, we see that, which contains any deleted or tampered files. So you can actually, if you are a forensic expert, you can actually avail the services of an expert to check whether this file has been overwritten, modified, how many times, when was that, timestamp, everything will be shown. Unless it is formatted, yes. Reformatted, number of times, then it goes to a zero level formatting, it's difficult to recover it. But it depends on the state of condition of that hard disk. If it's not a professional person who's, done the same, we can still recover data many times.
No, the only option we had, we requested the judge to send it to forensic. He says, you have seen the overburden, this 3-4 lab we have. We can't send it for a private litigation. We have a criminal matters where we are sending. Ultimately, my client had to settle with him, knowing fully well that these all are a manufacturer. So, Now the you have rightly pointed out the Basir Ahmed and subsequent judgment. Now the stringent measures which makes sure that these documents are not tampered has been relaxed. Even Supreme Court says that all right, no certificate has been given, it can be given at any point of time. Whether you have not done it, somebody comes it and files customary certificate. Yes, data is intact. So therefore I am saying what has been envisaged that to protect your interest, that has been basically compromised in a subsequent judgment, making more acceptable, making more comfortable. This is the drawbacks which I understand.
True. But you know, there are cases where we have even seen that in the court, in the presence of the court, if that machine is brought and an expert is there, brought there and then, in order to expedite the whole process, and in certain cases mirror imaging has happened in the court premises while during the hearing, and if it's not a huge data, just to check that data is not a difficult task. That will save time as well. But provided that can be arranged, that is the thing. Just like we appoint an LC, we have an for an like an expert testimony, we can have somebody come and check it in the court premises. That may be possible.
We are also learning.
Yes, yes. It's all a growing field, you see. Yes. I mean, this is there. Yes. Any other questions?
Yes, please. Yeah, please. Just talk about this. Employee taking a debtors from the suppose when you pay the business restaurant, how can you protect it? He's using his pen drive, bringing some letter from outside also, inside into the computer. He's doing his own work and enforce on his the transaction of his space. He's taking away data from that. How can you protect it? It's very difficult for
it is process. It is possible through
suppose
technical means.
Yeah, is creating a parallel
correct. No, there is a software which is called a DLP software, data you know, leakage prevention software, which triggers the moment there is a you know, any attempt of anybody stealing data, whether it is through passing through email or through a pen drive. This DLP software is like an antivirus which sends you an automatic alert. So that's how huge companies are able to monitor how data is being, you know, used and avoid the misuse of the same. So I think we need, it's a day and age where we not only need an antivirus, we need a anti-spyware, because people are using keyloggers and sending them in small snippets and messages, which if you click, your system is compromised, your whole data and the phone can be hacked. And if the phone is hacked, that's all the more a difficult thing, because then OTP will also come on that screen and the criminal is sitting there and he's seeing your screen on his system. So these days, not only antivirus, spyware, anti-spyware, then also you need this DLP in big organizations.
The relationship is so close proximity. The relationship is very close. How can you say that this man will be misused by that?
No, there are. That's why we have CISOs, Chief Information Security Officer's role is this only, to monitor what is happening to the data in the company, and his job is only to see that there's no misuse. That's why people are putting, there's a special officer for that called CISOs, and he has a whole gamut of team of people who are supervising this on their screens, just like CCTV monitoring, I can say that.
Even company can harass the employee also in this way.
Yes. I am dealing with one of the similar cases that you are saying currently, and very interesting, is before the Delhi High Court, and there on the first date of hearing, ex parte injunction was granted against the employee, whereas he has not done anything. Only because after serving say 18-19 years in his profession, he thought of moving on to another company. This company doesn't want to lose him. So as a restraint of trade, they have immediately filed a suit on the charges of data theft and filing such huge DLP reports saying that he has stolen data. And there we are arguing, how can that be possible? If DLP systems were being used in that company, it should have sent an automatic alert the moment there was a data theft. And the moment there was a data theft, you should have acted, your team should have acted. Now as a belated strategy, as an afterthwart, just to thwart his attempts from moving on in his career, you are stopping him because of putting false charges. So this is what is happening today.
Under this current regime of IT Act, when a fiduciary or an intermediary steals our data, like from through Section 43A, can we protect ourselves or can we claim compensation? Is it feasible according to your practical and knowledge? Like in the case of Cambridge Analytica, we have seen that
correct.
Facebook was summoned before a Congress sitting in USA, but
yes.
they eventually didn't subpoena anybody.
Mm.
So in
True.
India, can this be done in case we have seen this instance of
crime? So rightly said, 43A is an obligation on the part of any company
yes.
to maintain reasonable security practices. While they are collecting our data, they have to ensure security. In case there is a breach, which is on their part, they are liable to compensate us. Also, there is another provision, 72 in the IT Act, which is against breach of confidentiality and privacy. If somebody gives away our data, which is supposed to be maintained by law, and unauthorizedly and without permission gives it away, he is again liable for 3 years of imprisonment. 72A is for a private party. Supposingly, a telecom company only gives our CDR, all our call record data. Obviously, he is accountable. And there's again a punishment of up to 3 years there. So you can claim compensation, you can also sue him criminally. That is possible.
In practical scenario, is workable?
If it is an Indian company, definitely all the data is going to be here. And they have to maintain it for almost a year. So if you are quick in action, you can get hold of it. But if it is a company which is abroad, that becomes a challenge. Because they don't want to come here as a witness. Nor do they, they just probably file an affidavit saying that they, you know, either they will dispute jurisdiction. That's happening in most cases. They will dispute jurisdiction or they will say, none of our servers are here. If you want data, you ask for a saponia. And they will simply file an affidavit saying we have no control over, our data is not in India. That is a challenge. I agree because that's why I said that we need a convention. Or some sort of a strong MOU between countries, especially holding our data there. And thankfully, this new regime, I think, will ease out these issues. With data localization being the norm, we will be able to immediately get hold of data, which we currently are not able to. That's the
norm. Madam, being a consumer,
yeah.
how can we assume whether my data is protected or not? Because nowadays, we are using different apps.
Correct.
And providing our data to different companies. So how can we assume whether my data is protected?
First of all, in the useful tips for you all to understand, I never sign in with a common password and a user ID like in Facebook. They say, you sign in with your Facebook account. Because in the moment you're doing that, in number of cases, they're taking away all the data which you have in the Facebook also at times. Depends on what is the relationship between the two companies. So when you sign in an app, one must read what are the terms there. Are they actually going to sell our data also? Because you might be, using the app for example, for compiling of your contact details of people who you know. There's a compiler also online possible. So with that, everything is taken away. All your contacts are there in the app as well, and they can freely share it with anybody they want to. So give them this free hand at doing this is what we need to see. None of us read this. That is a problem.
Now,
so that's why express consent is needed in that. Yes, sir.
Yes, people keep writing on Twitter and Facebook.
Yes, sir.
One of my friends asked me very seriously, that can we publish these comments on Twitter and Facebook in a book form?
Oh.
Who? Can you do it? Does he own or somebody else owns it?
The owner of content usually in these cases is the person who has put it, the third party. But the website also takes an exclusive royalty-free license to exhibit that
Facebook.
Content. Yes, sir.
I'm actually talking of Facebook.
Yes. They normally have this as a copyright, they also take the right to publish that content because it has been put by the user willingly on this platform. So they have the right, but somebody else making a compilation and producing it may not be right because
person who is putting his comments, after 4 years there become so many.
Then he
so
can.
He wants to publish in
certainly,
book form.
Certainly, sir. There, I think the terms of conditions I have seen on Facebook, they say that the author is him.
Author
so obviously, all they are reserving their rights is to publish that content.
Oh, they know.
And to probably even modify it if they want to create something else, derivative rights. But certainly the original owner doesn't give away as an assign his rights. He may give a license to the site. That's the difference.
Suppose this Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, yes, the data kept regarding electoral this thing. So if you proved, one way Aadhaar is saying it cannot be.
It cannot be.
Suppose proved, what is the punishment?
So if there has been hacking, up to 3 years of imprisonment of those people who have hacked, Section 66 is very clear. And that will be a punishment, plus the loss which has been caused, that has to be compensated also. Yeah, but now in, class action suits, we have seen in the US, like in Amazon's case, I have seen that against Alexa, there was a controversy and there was a case, and $40 each victim was given. But here, I'm not sure who all have been victims in that case and whether that kind of a redressal will be available. That both, has to be seen. Yes, but at least criminal, we are aware that there is a provision, and it should work in that case.
So that the quantum of damages in terms of 73 and 74 of the Contract Act, we have to prove it?
Quantum of damages, yes, because like a number of cases, if for example, if there is an unjust enrichment by a company, like I have explained this case of employees who have, jointly conspired to create a parallel company, the profit and loss account of that company, how much they have illegally gained because of the theft.
Yes.
That has to be looked into, and how much loss, for example, if they have diverted our clients, we had retainership with those clients, so how much have we lost there? So all these things are taken into account to compute damages.
Okay.
So
in
this era of data protection, what happens in one country hacks the data, sensitive data of another country. Say for example, if two countries are in war or are not in good terms, one country hacks another country. Say for example, X country hacks the data of India. What is the remedy available to India?
Okay, so the public international law, this sphere of law will also get invoked because two countries have a different relationship. They have signed probably some MOUs. You will have to look into that. Some conflict of law issues also, because then it becomes a political dispute rather than just a pure private party dispute. So those dimensions will have to be looked into.
And especially in the era of terrorism now, terrorists are hacking into data rather than things. So
correct.
This is one issue that has to be tackled.
Absolutely. Yes. So that is why I strongly advocate that we should have a convention on cybercrime, because over the years, in the last 20 years, I've seen the way...
No convention as undead, we don't have any single convention?
No, in fact, we don't. We are not a signatory to any of the conventions. We have bilateral treaties. We have, convention against transnational organized crime. But we don't have for cybercrime. We need a very quick timeline to, immediately act the moment there's a cybercrime, because it's so intangible. Like, you can just destroy a data in few seconds. So that is the need of the hour, because if we are going global and we have already done that, so you need to protect yourself against transborder crime. Fortunately, I was part of a think tank recently where the Vivekanand International Foundation, this foundation worked on with all the Army Navy Air Force officers, retired Army Navy officers, with over 40 years of experience. They were also part of the think tank where we were looking at cyber deterrence. The deterrence is that on our borders, what kind of vigilance is allowed in terms of cyber activity? Can we do packet sniffing? Can we do, send any kind of, emails or any kind of vigilance or surveillance activities? Is it legal in the international, law, legal domain? How much is permissible? For example, if we were to only deter ourselves, only to safeguard ourselves, is that enough, or we should be proactive also? So these were the considerations there, and interestingly, the report is available online. I can share the link with you if you'd like to read that. And the Honorable Defense Minister released it just last month. So it's very good.
That's why you are photographic at that time.
Yes. Yes. So it was a very good report. on this issue of cyber terrorism and hacking and how different countries need to collaborate, and India needs to safeguard its position, basically.
Any more questions? Anyone? Thank you very much, Karnika.
My pleasure. My pleasure.
Really, very simplified. So many doubts day to day life.
Thank you so much.
The beauty of the Karnikas, we met accidentally in ISIL long back. That's 1.5-2 years back. Then I very serious problem Friday group next day speaker. One speaker had some problem. Then I requested by phone. She's within 30 minutes. She said yes, and she joined that time. We need such a dynamics. And we'll see, who are you? She never asked. She simply jumped and she came. Very next day she addressed. That is the beauty of us. We are all proud to be.
I'm always very eager to interact, because I've interacted with police officers across India. Almost 5 lakh of police officers.
Oh.
And from the National Judicial Academy, National Police Academy, or the CBI, BPR&D. Close to 100 institutions by now, and every time I go, it's not one-way process. I always get to learn. So it's an enriching process for me. Every interaction counts. And we are all students of law, so we never stop learning. We never stop learning. So this is the reason why whenever there's a possibility of interaction and there is a good group like yours, where we can learn from each other, I am very eager to go and speak.
Thank you very much, Karnika. It's so nice of you, really wonderful.
Want to share one more thing. Because I've been doing these workshops and trainings, I interacted with chartered accountants and different people from different areas, government, like we were making with the Home Ministry a law on fake news recently. So interesting issues happen, and from the legal fraternity, your inputs, you may not directly interact with them, but I then at that point I'm a representative of our fraternity, and then able to contribute effectively. That is the I think beneficial step there. And because of this, I set up an NGO only for training law enforcement, children, parents, teachers, academia. And that's called Foundation for Institutional Reform and Education. So apart from my active practice, which is in cyber law, primarily I'm also doing not-for-profit, like pro bono work. And there I, whenever in a calendar, I just keep 4 or 5 days and then I go and speak at schools, because I like interacting, and they're the ones who tell us the real life problems, everyday problems, and they share these issues with us. And then we are able to guide them that, with the blue whale incidents, it created havoc. And there are several children who are undergoing depression and anxiety. And there are many schools who do not have the counselors to guide the children. So they are finding it as a very big, help, because somebody can come and explain the kids the do's and don'ts of internet, which even the parents are not aware. So when one session at Shivna, the school, we had only with parents, and at some schools like DPS, we talked to close to 500 children, and then they would share their difficulties, problems. Sometimes they would, take my email ID or my phone number, and after the session, I will get chain of mails and queries. Earlier it used to be police officers and other people, writing. Now it's children also writing. But I find it as a very fascinating thing, because at least, God has given me the knowledge to share, which is what I really cherish. So thank you so much. You all
heard us. Last question. It's a selfish question. It's a open mind. You, according to a statement, you met 5 lakhs people, interacted and other. How you see this Friday group and other thing? What is your feeling, expression, just to...
I have to thank you from the bottom of my heart.
So nice of you, sir.
Seriously, Mr. Shali, this is a step which very few people take.
Okay.
And I don't know how many bars have organized a program like this out of voluntary, initiation. And the eagerness for all of us to learn from each other, and the eagerness for us to evolve in terms of learning and as a community, this I have seen only in Friday group. I have only seen in Friday. And I'm so proud that I'm, you know, coming here for the second time, able to interact with each one of you. And I may have done previously, but every time I come, I just feel very, very happy to be a part of this Friday group and the legal fraternity. Because we have a long way to go. And the efforts which you are all making is setting an example for all the bars of the entire country, that they should also, you know, it doesn't have to be a seminar, a formal seminar or a conference. But if you have the will, and the curiosity to learn, you can actually create a seminar every afternoon or every Friday afternoon.
Thank you.
So thank you so much.
And Muthu, please give a vote of thanks.
It was like it's not an ordinary session, this one. We've been dealing with lot of laws, and probably this one, the data protection, I think it's, though we are using data every day, we don't know about data protection. In fact, we are sitting in Supreme Court, and recently we had our Supreme Court website that was hacked.
Correct.
And some Brazilian hackers hacked it, and I don't know whether what happened, but I don't know what is the logical conclusion that took place. So this, I think we need it at this hour, and probably to have heard it, and I guess all of them would have benefited a lot. And probably, I don't know, we must also evolve in formulating laws and other things, and I think since we have been exposed to it, probably we should probably work towards evolving. That is what is my opinion. And thanks a lot once again, and we hope that there are more sessions.
Yeah. And are you all aware of, I'm sure you're all aware of the e-courts filing, e-filing.
Yes.
I don't know how many lawyers have really started doing, but initially this software was developed by this Supreme Court committee. And we were working on another software, then this software came about, and this I think is going to be used by 18,000 courts in India and 21 high courts, and already a lot of them have started using.
Very effective.
Yes, very effective. And I had gone to academy JNK. There also, Honorable Justice Geeta Mittal, I had spoken to her about the e-filing and how effective we are, you know, using this. And they were very keen that, you know, this particular e-filing is really doing a lot in terms of saving time, money, costs, and, you know, effectiveness to any ordinary man. He can at least go and file a PIN if he wants to. If he has any grievance, he can actually do that. So I was fortunate that I was involved in this drafting of the manual. I actually wrote the manual there, and that becomes a big sign of solace that the judges or the, you know, lawyer community appreciates that the effectiveness of the tool. So my urge to you all will be that please propagate it among your friend circles, your bar members, and we are continuing to support this e-filing initiative taken by our Supreme Court. So thank you so much.
Thank you.